là, vous le connaissez, ça fait un bon moment, ça fait un bon moment qu'il est une référence dans le domaine de la psychologie de la musique, en partie parce qu'il a développé d'une manière tout à fait originale et pour moi passionnante cette question d'une approche écologique de l'écoute, de la perception sonore. Et là, je renvoie à son livre très important, Ways of Listening, qui est paru en 2005 et qui est une référence pour le genre de problématique. Depuis et avant, bien sûr, Eric a publié beaucoup de choses, je vous recommande d'aller voir. En tout cas, je mentionne ce livre parce que je pense qu'il est vraiment un point de repère très important pour les questions qui nous intéressent. Et donc, merci encore une fois, Eric, nous vous écoutons avec beaucoup
d'intérêt. Merci, Esteban. Et je suis désolé, je m'excuse pour ne pas parler français, mais c'est ça. Ok, so, I have two titles, really. The title that you have in the program today is this, but in many ways, I think this title perhaps expresses in a different way the things that I'm going to talk about for the next half to three quarters of an hour. So the title of today's colloquium seems to me to offer two perspectives, and actually Esteban has already indicated, I think, these two ways of understanding the title. One is to consider how the position of listening has changed in kind of human ecology more broadly and more generally since the digital turn, which might be or digital swerve, perhaps one should call it in English. And the other is to consider what light might be shed on listening in relation to this same digital turn by ecological theory. And I'm going to try and talk about both of these to the first of them rather less, because this is less my own work, and the second one slightly more, because that is closer to my own work. So to start with the position of how the position of listening may have changed in human ecology since the digital turn. What I've listed here really is just a very small selection of the considerable amount of work that has been published recently, and some of it not even so very recently, that has considered the ways in which, first of all, has considered the history of listening, which has been perhaps a rather overlooked subject, but also particularly has considered changes in listening and changes in the history of listening in the light of technological change. Peter Sandy's book, Tia Denora, in various different kinds of work. Her book from 2000, Music in Everyday Life, I think was a very important way of starting to discuss the embedding of musical listening in people's everyday practical practices. And her more recent book, Music Asylums, takes this in a very particular direction in relationship to the way in which music is incorporated into people's lives in the specific area of kind of music therapy, health and well-being, conceived within a rather broad notion of music as a particular form of consciousness. And the chapter within that book called Musicalizing Consciousness is, I think, a very interesting way of seeing how musical consciousness and musical subjectivity are kind of structured by musical practices. Jules-Antoine Nancy's book on listening, which is perhaps less concerned with these technological issues, but concerned with a fairly sustained philosophical treatment of listening. Jonathan Stern's work on the history of recording devices and so on. Anahid Kasabian's book, Ubiquitous Listening, which whose subtitle is something like And Distributed Subjectivity, which is also a very I think, a very interesting collection of writings about the ways in which, again, different kinds of musical technologies have facilitated or afforded new ways of being, not only with music, but as it were, more generally with music as the facilitating and mediating and structuring medium for those ways of being. Michael Bull's work on starting out with the Walkman, but the ways in which mobile listening devices have changed, again, the ways in which we engage with music and how we use music in our everyday lives. Georgina Bourne, the reference here is to the... she wrote an afterword to the Cambridge Companion to Recorded Music, of which I was one of the co-editors with Nicholas Cook, John Rink, and Dan Leach-Wilkinson. And as Georgina quite often tends to do, her introductions to her own edited volumes, and sometimes the afterwords that she has often produced, are often fairly substantial pieces, or in some cases enormously substantial pieces of writing in their own right. So her afterword to our recording volume is, I think, a really interesting piece of work about the mediation and remediation of music by virtue of recording technologies, in which she explores, I think, in both pre-digital and digital ways, the ways in which recording has transformed the musical media in various fashions. And recently also this enormous, nearly 1,000-page, two-volume handbook by Sumanth Gopinath and a colleague of mine, Jason Stanek, in Oxford, the Oxford Handbook of Mobile Listening Studies, which is an enormous kind of compendium of ways in which music's increasingly mobile status has changed the way we think about music. So, using that as a kind of backdrop, just to say this is quite a lot of work, but this is only a small proportion of all the work that could be mentioned. I think some of the issues that arise out of this kind of approach to the changing ecology of listening are, first of all, different attitudes, I would say, to what some people have called the auditory term, the date of which one might set at various different numbers, but I suppose, you know, certainly for the last 20 years or so, perhaps, there has been a kind of sense that whilst the visual has dominated cultural studies and perhaps the humanities quite generally, that a turn from the scopic or the visual to the auditory allows us to think about all kinds of issues in different ways. And one of the ways in which that some people have wanted to see this is that the auditory, it has been claimed, is kind of more, somehow more connected to questions of embodiment and affect and the tactile and the immediate and the kinesthetic and so on. I'm actually, I sometimes think, and I'm certainly not alone in this, but I think a number of people, I too, have been a little skeptical of this at times, and I think there is sometimes a feeling that the auditory is somehow more ineffable than the visual, that the visual is somehow kind of concrete. There is something about the association of the visual with some kind of sense of immediacy and spatiality, whereas the auditory has been kind of associated with not with spatiality so much as temporality, and because there have been questions about, you know, if the world unfolds in time, which obviously it does, then from a perceptual point of view, does it offer a kind of more problematic, a more, in a sense, a more interestingly problematic question about how we grasp temporally distributed information as opposed to visually distributed, spatially distributed information. I think there are some, I think there is the danger of a kind of slightly magical thinking there, and that actually we encounter this relationship between the visual and the spatial in arguably a slightly a way that is not very representative. We have the sense that we grasp a visual scene in a single moment and that it has no temporal unfolding, but actually a moment's thought indicates that, you know, to look at a painting actually requires one to scan that visual, that spatial surface in a way that clearly takes time, so that there is perhaps nothing so very much more temporal about the auditory than the visual. And similarly, although we think of the visual as being a very spatial sense, audition is actually an incredibly acute and very important sense by which we pick up the spatiality of the world. The psychologist Anthony Storr, an English psychologist Anthony Storr, who was a Jungian psychologist and very interested in music and wrote about music in a kind of, he wrote a book called Music and the Mind in about 1990. In it he said that if he had to choose between being blind or deaf, he would much rather be blind than deaf, which I think many people would say they would much rather be deaf than blind, but he said he would much rather be blind than deaf because deafness leads to a kind of, in his view, leads rather easily to a kind of paranoia, because you only know what is in front of you. You know nothing about what is behind and to the side of you, whereas but because of the focal nature of human vision. Whereas the ambient and, as it were, 360-degree quality of hearing allows one to have a much more complete notion, sense of one's spatial environment. I've often thought that was an interesting corrective to the view that audition is temporal and vision is spatial. A second kind of issue that arises out of the kind of literature that I had on the previous slide, which definitely was alluded to in these opening remarks, is about the ways in which digital technologies have changed the distribution, dissemination, kind of interpenetration, ubiquity, porosity, fluidity, all of these ways in which music's place, metaphorically and literally, in everyday life has been changed in interesting and powerful and playful and practical ways. And I only note that, I have nothing really to add to it. I think that has been a very important change. It has had fantastically powerful democratizing consequences apart from anything else. And it has had some important creative, it has released some very important creative possibilities, such as the possibilities of people collaborating in all kinds of places and times in various kinds of musical creative work. So in other words, it speaks to the question, the ways in which digital technologies have mediated and remediated musical material. So this term, which Georgina Bourne uses quite extensively in the piece of writing I mentioned before from 2009, the notion of remediation comes from the idea that if you have information, aesthetic objects that are in one medium, then the way in which media can increasingly take one medium and remediate that is an important part of the digital term. And those two points together lead to this, a word that has been used and kind of used and abandoned, it seems to me. It's less current than it was at one stage, but the term prosumption, meaning the ways in which production and consumption have become much more closely interleaved with the availability of digital technology. So I suppose you could, you know, the most obvious ways in which we see this going on enormously are in the sort of YouTube creativity that goes on, where people, you know, the kind of bedroom creativity, and of course it's not only bedrooms, but bedroom creativity that you see on YouTube with people, you know, people with variable musical skills, but with playful attitudes to musical materials, can take things as consumers and put them back out as producers in a fantastically closely connected cycle of activity. A kind of relationship with recorded music that really is radically different from not the whole period of the sound recording age, but certainly from a significant part of it. I suppose the kind of cassette period, the period from about sort of, I don't know, 1975 to 1983, you might say, or 1972 and 1983, was also a period when people, with a much less flexible technology, of course, started to record music and put music together in, but the most you could do then really was a kind of compilation process rather than this much more sophisticated remediation that the internet has made possible. And finally then, of this list of some of the issues that come out of the literature I just alluded to, I think it has raised some very interesting questions about liveness in music, and music, and not only music, of course. What do we mean? What really is live anymore? And there are questions here, so there are kind of ontological questions and value questions. So the kinds of ontological questions arise for instance, in the case of so-called live simulcasts between the Metropolitan Opera in New York and Oxford or Paris. So when you go to a cinema to see a live performance from the Met, you kind of enter into, as happens in cinemas in the UK, you kind of enter into what feels like a live relationship in some ways with what's going on. But if you ask yourself, you know, if the delay between New York and Oxford is, 15 seconds or something like that, you feel kind of as though you're participating in something that is kind of truly live. But if the delay is an hour, now does it feel live? And if the delay is a day, surely now we have to call it a recording. And so you get to these kind of questions about what is really the threshold between live participation. You know, if we went, if there was something on at the Opera here and there was a huge audience wanting to see it and they couldn't all get into the building and they had a screen outside, then I think many people would feel that they were participating as live members of that audience, even though they were watching the performance on a screen and hearing it over loudspeakers. And you know, how far do you have to extend that before you regard this not as being live? And associated with that, the other side of that might be, if you go and hear a band playing at a gig and that band is using quite a proportion of what is being presented live is actually pre-programmed music that is being triggered in various ways. Do we regard that still as being part of live performance? And if we don't, then do we regard this simply as being the kind of, I don't know, the fake production of something that looks like a live performance but is actually a triggered recorded performance or something like that? And so those, the kind of, as it were, ontological questions about what is live connects in interesting ways with questions of value, whether we regard the live experience as having intrinsically somehow more value than the recorded experience. And I think We have lived through an age in which people regarded recorded music as being, and people have written about it in these ways, have regarded recorded music as being a kind of poor cousin of the real thing. And I think we are emerging out of that into a more complex understanding of those values, and perhaps a more complex understanding that is connected partly to different kinds of music and the different ways in which different kinds of music make those values differently. So to move on from that, because time will run on otherwise, let me say a little bit then about the second part of my unpacking of today's title. So what light might be shed on listening by ecological theory, and in particular, what light might be shed in relation to the digital term. So these are five, if you like, ecological principles, or five principles that relate to an ecological perspective on listening. And the first is that, contrary to some other theories of listening, which have presented the world as being a kind of chaotic, in the words of William James, sort of booming, buzzing confusion, which we have to make sense out of, in contradiction to that, ecological theory points out something very, it seems to me very, very clear and very obvious in a sense, and that is that the environment actually presents us with information that is already highly structured, and that that information specifies a world to us. It doesn't specify it in a completely deterministic way, of course, but it presents us with already structured information. And the question of perception is, what sense do we make of that information? So here's a sound clip. So at the beginning of the sound clip, it's not clear what's going on here, because the sounds are they're quite complex and could specify quite a lot of different kinds of things. And by the time it resolves into a kind of I can make those sounds. These are exactly the same. It was actually a packet of quavers that I used to make that recording. So if I do it with a real, with an object which is very live and so on, and do all of those things, including. Then there is no doubt what is going on, because one of the things about perception is that it generally, overwhelmingly, goes on in a multimodal and multi-sensory fashion in which our various senses collaborate. I mean, that's too anthropomorphic a way of putting it, but they work together so as to resolve uncertainties in our environment. And one of the things about music since the age of recording is that the capacity to present sounds in an acousmatic fashion has radically changed some of those deeply seated kind of certainties, if you like, and have made them interestingly uncertain. So the second, a second principle of ecological theory is that perception is a kind of, and this is important, the developing part of this is important, is a developing attunement to the environment. I think one of the misconceptions about Gibson, and Gibson is not the only ecological theorist, but Gibson's theory is a kind of feeling that it is a universalist and essentialist theory of perception, that we are somehow born into the world with a tuned relationship with our environment, so we pick it up in some sort of almost magically immediate way. He certainly never claimed that, and whatever he claimed anyway, I don't think an ecological theory needs to come anywhere close to such a position. It is quite clear that an infant is born into the world with very powerful, but as yet extremely unformed, sensory and perceptual capacities, and that the whole of our lives are spent becoming more and more refined in our tuning to the available information in the environment. The studies, for instance, of wine, and we do this mostly in an untutored way, simply through exposure to the world and becoming more and more refined in noticing differences, to put it simply. And those differences come out also from the kind of interdependence between perception and action. Again, a lot of theories of perception have presented perception as if it was mostly a kind of reflective and ruminative kind of relationship with the world. But that is absolutely, perception is mostly a very tight relationship, but in fact a continuity between perceiving and acting. And this sound clip, someone trying to tune the two strings of a violin, is a kind of illustration of exactly that relationship between perception and action. If you imagine the person with their hand on the tuning peg, and what they're doing is continuously changing the relationship between what they perceive and what they do and the consequences of that. And of course we do that in all kinds of ways. And that relationship is expressed in the term affordance, a word which I continue to find a very useful way of thinking about not only music, but music amongst other things. So Gibson defined an affordance as the kind of opportunities for action, or the opportunities that an environment presents to a perceiver who has certain kinds of capacities. And the important thing about his definition of affordance is that it is absolutely a dialectical concept that is neither about fixed properties of the environment, nor is it about, as it were, the imposition of a view by the perceiver on the environment. It is when those two things come together. So this object here, for instance, affords, for me, it affords pointing at things. Whoops, if it works. Sometimes it does and sometimes it doesn't. Okay, it's not affording at the moment, being used as a pointer. And it affords that because I know that I have certain needs and capacities, and it has certain properties. But it also affords, I don't know, for instance, levering open a door that has become stuck, or it might afford using as a object to call people to attention because I know they can make noise on a hard surface or whatever. So objects have all kinds of affordances, but there isn't really any way, I think, that this object can afford transporting me back to my hotel, let's say, at the end of the day, because however much I would like it to do that, it simply doesn't have properties that allow that. So applying this to music, I think, has been a smallish volume of writing about music's affordances, I think is an interesting way about thinking about, and Gibson again made this equivalence, of thinking about meaning in a way which again ties up perception and action, and also puts meaning as being a kind of, if you like, a contract between properties of the object and capacities of the organism. And then finally, this idea that there is of course a distinction between nature and culture, but there isn't, as it were, a sharp division between nature and culture, and that culture is built on the same kinds of attributes as nature. I think I'll skip my next clip. So, if those are some kind of basic ecological principles, there are interesting ways in which music kind of ruptures some of those adaptive relationships with the world. So, the relationship between perception and action in some musical cultures, and of course not in all musical cultures, but in some musical cultures, if you like, art music cultures, and I don't just mean Western art music, but other kinds of art music cultures, in which the relationship between perception and action is partially severed. So the difference between that kind of participatory listening that many vernacular cultures encourage, in which people join in and sing along and dance to and help to make the music in which they are also listeners, versus the kind of concert listening culture. And here is an image actually from the mid to late 19th century, but this is a lithograph of Beethoven playing for his friends. So it's a lithograph of an event taking place, I suppose, at roughly just after the turn of the 19th century, but it's actually made in 1877. So this is a kind of late-ish 19th century view of listening. And the interesting thing about this lithograph is the way in which none of the friends, and actually there is, although you can't see it very clearly just now, there is a statue even up here. Not even the statue, let alone the human beings, is actually looking at Beethoven. Even though he clearly is the source of whatever it is that they are hearing. So the attitude of listening, in which listeners are drawn into their own inner world rather than, as it were, focused on the outer world. So all of these people are either staring into some sort of middle distance or looking up or down, and you can see. So this attitude of entering into a kind of an other world is a way in which perception and action, in the most obvious way, have been kind of drawn apart. And as I've already mentioned, the acousmatic, the possibility of presenting musical sound acousmatically, so in the absence of the concrete source, leads to the kind of, as it were, the modern equivalent of exactly the same kind of attitude, that kind of sinking into a virtual world that is somehow separate from the real practical world in some ways. So I think it is the capacity of music to have a interesting relationship between real and virtual environments that is one of the crucial things about it, and one of the reasons why we are drawn into the kind of powerful relationship with music that we have. And that capacity, that moment, is less, I think, to do with the digital turn than really with this moment, the kind of Thomas Edison 1877 moment, where for the first time sounds could be kind of abstracted from their concrete production. And although it took a while for the kind of the power of that abstraction to become realized, it has been a very powerful moment. And I think that the the change from being able to do that with analog technologies to digital technologies is perhaps less profound, even though it has had some of the consequences I've already mentioned. It's perhaps less profound than that moment itself. Let me just say a little bit about virtual world, because I've used this term without being very clear about it. So this doesn't show terribly well, but this is a painting that some of you will probably know anyway. So this is Velázquez's Las Meninas, a painting that has been discussed quite a lot, and we can use this as an example of a kind of virtual world. So there are many things about this painting. It isn't terribly clear, but you may see it well enough. There are many things about this painting that are, in a sense, rather like a real world. In the painting, a space with recognizable kinds of objects and people are specified, and it is a kind of space that we can imaginatively enter. So we see Velázquez here with the back of a painting towards us, which in some sort of strange and paradoxical way we might imagine could even be the painting that we are simultaneously looking at. And there are people and a dog and a doorway and a man going out of that doorway, and a sense of three-dimensionality, and as has been widely commented upon, this curious thing here, which looks like a mirror, which appears to be reflecting the subject position, the subject point that we as viewers are occupying. But what we see reflected back to us is actually two people, and those two people are the king and queen of Spain. And so it is a virtual space which causes us to be uncertain about various things, but it does so by specifying a kind of world that is in some senses very familiar and interpretable, and in other senses paradoxical and question-raising. But notice that, the ways in which it does this, and because of the reproduction is on this screen is not very good, it's not quite so clear, but the way in which it does this is quite different from the way in which the space in this room is specified to us. So as I look around the room and see its three-dimensionality, that is to do with the way in which light is reflected off surfaces that have different kinds of reflectance and different degrees of transparency and so on. Whereas the same kinds of properties, so for instance, the property of this looking like a reflection is caused, of course, not by actual reflection, but by the use of pigment on canvas that affords similar ways of understanding it in spatial terms, but affords them by virtue of very different kinds of properties. So, you know, the sense of the reflecting property of this panel, as opposed to, you can't see them very well, but these are large paintings which look very much like paintings, and this like a reflection, is because this uses quite a lot more white pigment. And white pigment, of course, is not truly reflection at all. It is a way of conjuring up, if you like, a sense of reflection using quite different means. So in a slightly similar way, here is a short extract from a track by a band called the Avalanches, who use a lot of sampling in their music. And this short extract, about a minute or so of music, conjures up a lot of different kinds of, if you like, spaces and objects in a kind of musical virtual world. You will hear bits of talking, and you'll hear the sounds of horses, and you'll hear a little bit of the film music from the Lawrence of Arabia, the film music composed by Maurice Jarre from a 1962 film. And you will hear, in fact, that the way in which the band kind of referenced their own methods of composition through the sounds of turntablism and scratching and so on. All of these things put together into a kind of collage or combination that creates a kind of virtual world that we can enter, just as we can enter the world of Las Meninas.
Dexter's challenging problem is swear hand. The Butler County School Board have decided to expel Dexter from the entire public school system.
I'm afraid you won't listen to me, but surely expulsion is not the answer.
Afraid expulsion is the only answer. It's the opinion of the entire staff that Dexter is criminally insane.
So this is a kind of music that is made out of a technology that allows, that affords the possibilities of making these virtual worlds, and which kind of refers to those own technologies in its own sounds. So I'll move quickly, I think, to some conclusions. First of all, I just want to say, I want to play two more examples. One, what do we think of as, with reference to this digital turn part of the title, what do we think of as being the sound of the digital in music? And I think the first way in which we think of the sound of the digital might be something like this. part of Kraftwerk's Tour de France, with all of those kind of properties of what we think of as being the digital in music, of kind of quantized rhythmic properties of computer-generated voices and so on. But actually, this is just as much the sound of the digital. So this was a recording by Jesse Norman of the Strauss Four Last Songs. It happens, it was released in, I think, 1982 or 3 on a CD. And for me, anyway, it was almost the first CD that I heard. I remember going to visit a musicological colleague of mine at the University of Exeter, a man called Jim Sampson, who had recently bought his first CD player and his first CD, and he said, "You've got to hear this most amazing sound." And in the depths of the countryside, Devon countryside in England, put on this extraordinary sound. And of course, this sound, which we don't hear as having any particular digital properties in the same way that we do with Kraftwerk, at the time was extraordinary because the kind of dynamic range and the clarity and all those kinds of things that were associated with CD were a radically new sound. But I think what I would want to show with this contrast is that what we think of as being the sound of the digital is can either be something that is made very apparent in the sound itself, or can be a completely transparent, as it were, or transaudient aspect of the medium. So on to a summary and some conclusions from this. First of all, what I've tried and what the ecological approach tries to emphasize is a kind of continuity between everyday and musical sounds, and that the impact of recording and has been to allow us to play with that continuity and discontinuity so that we can put music in this kind of virtual domain in which it has powerful capacities to draw us into virtual worlds of a kind that we find fascinating, and that the digital term has allowed undoubtedly allowed that process to become more kind of fluid and transformational, and has allowed a kind of dissemination that is important. Secondly, that I think that the fundamental question, I would say, that we are constantly asking of our world as we perceive it, is a kind of what's going on question. And that the diversity of what is going on in music, and not only in music, of course, but the diversity of what's going on is enormous. We are concerned with very physical and practical things, to find out what instruments are being played and how are people engaging with them. So we overlook the physicality and materiality of music at our peril. We continue to be fascinated by that very tangible quality of music, but at the same time, we are also asking ourselves the whole time, what's happening in terms of a narrative, in terms of a structure, in terms of the virtual worlds in which we are drawn. And I think for me, the interesting and powerful consequence of that is that it encourages a kind of analytical focus on musical materials, which I think is very important to retain, but an analytical focus that is, of course, a very different one from the score-based analytical focus, or it's complementary to the score-based analytical focus that has that preceded it. Thirdly, as I mentioned already, the notion of affordance is one in which the mutualism of perceivers and their environments is at the core of it, and that therefore this is a way of, I think, negotiating the sort of Scylla and Charybdis of, on the one hand, of a kind of determinism about what we mean by musical meaning, and on the other hand, a complete relativism that threatens to just go all over the place. And I think that by thinking about musical materials in relation to listener, and not only listener, capacities, a way through that black and white binary is offered. I've talked a lot about real and virtual environments and the way in which music allows us to kind of enter into the world. I use the word work here, but this could be process or event as well. So the ways in which music opens up virtual environments that have fascinating properties. And so finally then, I think that the question that I feel is raised by an ecological approach is actually something to do with the relationship between ecology and aesthetics, and between the apparent the possibility of a kind of conflict between notions of adaptation and an aesthetic notion of critique. We tend to think about, or at least from a kind of Gibsonian perspective, ecology might be seen to be very much to do with the way in which organisms are drawn into a kind of an easy and adapted relationship with their environments. But arguably, from many perspectives, aesthetic objects are precisely designed to try and disrupt and unsettle that easy and adapted relationship. And so I kind of end with a question, really, which is whether there is a potential conflict or contradiction between those two directions, between the adaptive nature of an ecological perspective and the critical nature of an aesthetic perspective. I don't think there is, because I think that the one depends on the other. I think that the critical ways in which aesthetic objects trouble and unsettle our perception of the world have to be founded on a way of encountering the world. And what the ecological approach is trying to do is to show what that basis is, and it is able, using those same mechanisms, to say, and these are the ways in which that can be put into uncertain and interesting relationship with more normative kinds of adaptive relationship. At that point, I will finish. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Eric. We do have some time for questions, so maybe I can ask.
When you spoke about the light to be shed on the sound effect, I would like you to reflect on this scopocentrism, implicit scopocentrism of this idea to consider sound and music in a kind of environment that is in the type of scopic volume. I want to be éclairé, lightened by some source, and because I found your talk really incredibly interesting, I would like you to try to emphasize more the type of digital transformation. How would you define, in the end, how would you define digital ecological music? I mean, would you say that it is one instrument more, or that it changes entirely the way that instrumental music and human perception are bound together in the musical experiment? I mean, is digital something else, or is it a continuation of this type of, I would say, ecological bounding between the human body and instrumental devices in order to produce sounds?
Thank you. I don't think I find myself drawn to both in two directions. I think in many ways the digital, as I was trying to emphasize, I think in many ways the digital element of the digital transformation is maybe a bit of an illusion, or rather may imply a degree of dramatic change that I think is not justified, and that the relationship between the digital and the analog in most of the ways in which we encounter music is actually an extremely sort of tangled one. All of the digital examples that I've been playing on this have actually come to you in the end in a completely analog fashion. In the end, all of them have been coming out of loudspeakers that are analog devices. So we actually don't encounter the digital in its, as it were, baldly digital form very often at all. It is a medium in which analog entities have become digitally communicated, but there is, you know, there is always an analog to digital conversion, and a digital to analog conversion. In fact, you know, at the level of the physiology, if you like, it's always analog. Or if you, or you could adopt almost the kind of neuroscientist perspective and saying that the whole of the human nervous system is in some sense digital, since nerve cells either fire or they don't fire. But we have no, you know, that it seems to me that understanding of the human brain as if it was a digital device is kind of meaningless. It's you know, we don't encounter our own consciousness as having a digital quality to it. So I think in some ways the digital term is a kind of distraction, or could be, and in some ways it is a kind of distraction, or at least it promises a whole set of problems which I think are non-problems. But I do think that it, of course, has had, from a kind of technological, from a more sociological perspective, the capacity for music to be shared and made and encountered and so on in massively distributed ways has, of course, been hugely transformational in certain respects.
Thank you. Maybe I have a follower of that question, which is actually I was struck, I think that was very much the sense of Al's question, and the fact that you tended to de-emphasize the dramatic quality of this digital term. And I understand why. And I think that your focus on the CD moment is very important in that respect, because after all, a CD is digital technology, but at the same time, it doesn't change anything from the point of view of sociology of practices, since it is a disc, exactly like the LP was. So there is definitely something symptomatic of the kind of ways we tend to dramatize or to over dramatize the shift.
Yeah.
But as you all. Suggested the reason, but you still maintain the difference between real and virtual. So my question is, why?
Yeah.
And what do you put exactly in real and virtual? Since you presented this dichotomy, but at the same time you suggested that it wasn't related to the digital at all, because you showed us a Velázquez painting to illustrate it. So
yeah.
What's the real and virtual actually mean in that situation we are?
Yeah, and this is a question which I think I feel, in a way, increasingly uncertain about, but which I kind of still feel is important. So I think the relationship between a real and a virtual environment is really to do with, is concerned with what kind of access to that environment is afforded. So a real environment affords access which is multisensory, which is in which the relationship between perception and action is continuous, and which can importantly be explored so that you can find out more about it than was first made available. So however much, if I go back to the Velázquez, however much we might want to know whether in the painting Velázquez is painting the painting that we are looking at, however much we want to know that, we know that there is no way we could ever find out. And that's part of why, that is part of the playful possibilities of virtual environments. They offer us some information, and they, by virtue of their virtuality, withhold other kinds of information. Whereas if this was a real environment, our first impulse would be, you know, as long as we weren't prevented from doing so by members of the Infanta's court, that we would go forward and just have a peer around, look around the corner of that painting. So virtual environments are presented to us, and the same is true of you know, these recordings that I've been playing as well. They don't offer the possibility for finding out how are those sounds made. We have to take them in the way in which we find them. Now, in some ways, music, even in contexts where we wouldn't normally want to call it as being a kind of virtual environment, already starts to make that sort of separation between our access to the environment. So, you know, the concert situation is one in which musical sounds become a bit like a kind of virtual environment. We can't interact with them in this very kind of engaged way. And so they start to take on the qualities of sort of self-contained and somewhat autonomous worlds, virtual worlds that we either, you know, willingly for a moment inhabit or not. But the complicated factor now is that, of course, the relationship between virtual environments and real environments has become, you know, is increasingly fluid. So, you know, as I sit here and move around my cursor using the tracker pad on my, this is a virtual environment in which my cursor is moving. But as we will have all experienced, you know, that the sense of the directness of one's connection, which is variable, of course, but there's a directness of one's connection between the actions that I make here and the things that are going on there, we've become so virtuosic in a sense in our capacities with these environments as to make those distinctions become increasingly, and so immersive video games and so on start to raise the question of where the boundaries between virtual and real environments lie. But it's still the case that those virtual environments of an immersive video game, let's say, still don't allow you to actually act upon those objects in quite the same way that this environment does. So it is around that boundary that I still want to maintain the distinction, but I you know, increasingly recognise that it is a questionable distinction.
And along that line, what might argue that the blurring of the difference between virtual and real would be more characteristic of the digital term than some kind of triumph of the virtual, as it's often said.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Thanks very much, Eric. I'm struck by this machine.
Yeah.
And you spoke of the move from the visual spatial to the auditory temporal. Now, this was auditory for speaking, but it has become a digital device for engaging in a very visual way with the environment. Mm. So you see hordes of tourists in the Musée d'Orsay taking selfies with the artwork behind them, which doesn't exist really for them because they never look at it.
Mm.
They only look at the image on there. But they are nonetheless engaging with that visual environment through digital technology. But we don't seem to do the same. I mean, we don't seem to have the same sonic relationship with the environment.
Yeah.
We don't go around recording the sounds on the streets and interacting with them in the same way. And I wonder why that is, because the technology allows us to do it.
No, I agree. And I was somewhere else recently where a seaside place where there happened to be an extraordinarily interesting pontoon bridge that was going up and down in the sea and making this amazing creaking sound. And I did get out my iPhone and record it. And I thought, I've only done this once or twice ever with this technology, which is just sitting there in my iPhone waiting for you to be used. So we are just as able to capture the sound of the world as we are the sight of the world. I think it is still something to do with, although I tried to downplay the relationship between the visual and the spatial and the auditory and the temporal, there is something still about the way in which the auditory requires and necessitates a kind of temporal engagement that we are increasingly impatient with. And I mean, this applies as much to, you know, we now have the technologies in which we could listen to, you know, entire Wagner operas in an uninterrupted and incredibly high fidelity way of a kind that has never before been available. But I bet there are fewer people doing that with those technologies than there might have been even in the era of the 78 RPM record, when you had to go and change it every 4 minutes, kind of thing. Because we have become, because our, you know, this sounds very very dystopian, and I don't mean it like this, but because we've become accustomed to rapid information retrieval and use. And I think it is partly for that reason, and I think it is partly because there is some sense in which the sharing of the auditory is a much more difficult thing than the sharing of the visual. I skipped past it, but I was going to talk about, this is using a program called Sonic Visualizer, a comparison of a two parts of a song by Cher, which very notoriously used it, a kind of digital transformation. But we can share the voice here by me saying, look at the way you have this kind of discrete quantized pitch movement up here and this more curvy kind of pitch movement there. We can share it in the visual domain in a way which feels somehow more palpable and more truly intersubjective than we can if I were to play this. I could play it and I could say, listen to X and listen to Y, but there is a kind of feeling of an uncertainty about whether we have, or whether we have really shared the same thing, because we can't point to it in the same way. We can't say, oh yes, you mean that bit which goes up here. You know, I can say, look at this discrete pitch jump here, and you can come over and you can say, no, you can quarrel with me or agree with me or whatever, in a way that is very different or difficult in the auditory.